It's great we're here. We're going to be talking today a little bit about money. And so right up front, I just want to say, if you're a guest here, if you're visiting us, and especially if you're somebody who doesn't follow Jesus, then you can listen in, but in no way are we wanting to grab any of your cash. This doesn't apply to you, some of this stuff, if you're not a follower of Jesus yet. If you do become a follower of Jesus, then this is the kind of thing that we talk about and that Jesus wants to take an interest in. If you're visiting from another church, I just want to encourage you to think through what we're saying for people who are based in this context. Does this apply to you in your context? So that's kind of the thing. The truth is, if you look at the Bible, you'll see that God wants to use money to change your heart. He wants to use money to change your heart. And he wants to use your money that he puts into your hands to change the world, to change people around you. I don't know if you are somebody who's earning any money at all. You may be or you may not be. If you are an average person in Croydon, your annual salary, the average annual salary in Croydon is £27,000 a year. And if you were to earn £27,000 a year, that would mean that each month you'd take home, after tax, around about £1,800. And if you worked for 45 years, which is the average amount of time that somebody would work, if you worked for 45 years, God would have put into your hands, through your working life, £1 million. £1 million. And internationally, and historically, that is a phenomenally large amount of money. It's incredible. And this doesn't include pocket money you may have been given when you were a child. It doesn't include pension payments that you might receive once you've finished work. It doesn't include inheritance or any other source of funds that you might get. You may think, I don't earn £27,000 a year. I earn half of that. Well, that's still £500,000. And what I want to suggest to you today is that that is money that God has deliberately put into your life. Every single penny that you receive has been sent into your pocket by God. And he wants to use those pennies and those pounds to change your heart, to set you free. And he wants to use those pennies and those pounds to set people free around you as you choose to use them to invest in others. And my laptop's gone off. So let's have a look at, I just want to talk you through the biblical stuff about money, because actually it's a massive theme. And I must admit, I've always been slightly hesitant to talk about money. If you've been around for a long time, you'll realize we've very rarely talked about this. That's true. Some of you have been around. And you know, more recently, some people have been asking, why have you not? And it's one of those great examples. We've talked a lot about diversity, where people from other church traditions enrich you because they ask you questions and it makes you think, hold on a minute, well, why do we not? Jesus talks about money. Probably about a quarter of all the sayings of Jesus deal with money or possessions. And so we want to follow Jesus' teachings. We want to talk about this stuff. And kind of my natural embarrassment is something I want to get over. And so I hope that today you might already be feeling a little bit like, oh my goodness, are we really going there? Well, yes we are. This is what Jesus does, and so this is what we want to try and do. So biblically, the question of money and how God would want us to use income comes up really early on in the Bible. The sort of the first time I think it's mentioned is where we see Cain and Abel. And we see that Cain and Abel are both the children of Adam and Eve. And they act in two different ways. And it says that Cain takes some of his crops and he offers them, he makes an offering. But Abel takes the first fruits of his crop and he offers them to the Lord. And so if you have a look, what you see is this is the sort of difference in pictorial form. Abel, the language of the Hebrew suggests it's the first things. He's kind of the best of what he has, he offers to God, and he keeps the rest for himself. And Cain equally makes an offering to God, but the suggestion is it's just an offering. It's not of the best. It's not of the first. And so we see there, God says, hey, Abel, that's brilliant. Well done. And you might know the story that Cain then gets a bit annoyed. It's like, well, why is he not like my offering? And he kills Abel. And so that's sort of That's not what happens when you make a good offering to the Lord. I hope you get killed, but you never know. Never know. That doesn't appear in much prosperity gospel teaching. I don't know why that doesn't. Anyway, so then the next time we see, I think, offerings talked about is Abraham, who's the child of the promise of God. And God says, I'm going to be with you. We've clicked on too much, but it's all right. And Abraham meets a guy who's Melchizedek. And Melchizedek is the priest of God Most High. And Abraham says, in recognition that God has provided me with all I have, in recognition that it was God Most High who enabled me to defend myself against the attack of the kings, I'm going to give 10% to you, Melchizedek. That's a recognition that actually God has made provision in my life. And Melchizedek blesses Abraham. If you click, then you get a sort of a sign, yes, this is good. This is good. This is God saying, this is good, what Abraham chooses to do. In his offering of 10% of his all he has, he offers it to Melchizedek. Then we see, click on, Moses. Moses is the great leader. If you don't know what we're talking about here, it's all right. It's sort of illustrative. But Moses is the guy who brings together the community of God. God uses him to set the people free from Egypt, out of slavery. They cross through the sea, and they arrive and they go to Mount Sinai. And God says through Moses, he says, look, as my people who I love, who I've set free, as my people, this is how I would have you live. This is what life looks like as one of my people. Because I love you and because you love me. And then he gives them the Ten Commandments. And after the Ten Commandments, he then goes through a whole series of laws, which is detailed in the book of Leviticus, which for those of you among us who have insomnia, I just want to release the gift of Leviticus into your life. But at the end of Leviticus, it talks about how actually God says the 10%, in a law of tithes, as a sign that you recognize I've provided for you, that I am your God, that all you have has come from me, I give you the law of tithes. And that's right at the end of the book of Leviticus. It acts as the closing bracket, as it were, on all of these ways you'll show that you're mine. And it ends with Leviticus. Now, Deuteronomy, which is a sort of a summary, a recap of all that Moses has taught, acts as like a, and it's one of Jesus' favorite books, Deuteronomy. And Deuteronomy chapter 26 also shows that what God says through Moses in that chapter is, I want you to take your first fruits. I want to give you your first fruits. But actually, more than just giving your first fruits to God, I want you to also give free will offerings and thanksgiving offerings to him. And God also establishes among his people an obligation of hospitality. An obligation of hospitality. So what he basically does, you can see it here, Deuteronomy 26, he says, look, the first fruits of what you have as my people, the first fruits goes to me as your God. And that's shown as you give it to the Levites, the ministers among you. They don't have any inheritance. They don't earn any income. They don't own any land. And so they rely on your giving. You give to them and also use your first fruits to care for the poor among you. Those who are struggling, those who don't have enough. The first fruits goes there, but then the rest of this stuff that's for you, I want you also to take some of that, and when you want to, give a free will offering, give a thank offering, which might be an animal. You might sacrifice an animal and you pay for that. There's a free will offering. It might be one of your own animals. An equally obligation of hospitality. If you have a stranger who comes into your midst, I want you to take them into your house and care for them. I want you to love those who have nobody loving them, the orphans and the widows. And this is how Deuteronomy and Leviticus, this sets it up. This is how God's people will live. This is how they will use their money. And then you see this is just established. And if you know the story of the Bible, you'll know that all through the Old Testament, it's a story of how God's people refuse to do what God wants. And they ignore it. And in whole manner of ways. And one of the ways in which they reject God's call of this is what it's like to be one of my people is with what they do with their money. Oh yeah, and he says this is good. God says this is good. And in fact, in Deuteronomy 28, there's a whole list of promises of blessings that God will release upon the people if they obey his calling. And in Deuteronomy 28, there's also a whole list of curses that will fall on the people if they don't follow his teachings and don't live as his people. And we get to Malachi, who's a prophet. So Malachi is kind of one of the guys who God uses to speak to his people and just remind them and say, look, I'm your God. I love you. I called you out of Egypt. I called you out of slavery. I claimed you as my own. I've given myself to you. Would you give yourself to me? You're not giving yourself to me. Why are you not giving yourself to me? I want you. I love you. I need you. You're my people. You're meant to be showing the whole world how gracious and generous and compassionate I am. And you're not doing it. And this is what the prophets say over and over. And Malachi particularly picks up on the issue of first fruits and of use of money. And I've just lost my computer, but would you guys pass me the Bible? And in Malachi particularly, in Malachi verse... In Malachi, I just want to read this because it's fascinating. Malachi is the last prophet to speak before God actually brings on the people of Israel some of the curses that he promised if they don't live how he wants them to live. And what he says is this. I, the Lord, do not change. So you, descendants of Jacob, you're not destroyed. Ever since the time of your forefathers, you've turned away from my decrees, and you've not kept them. So he's referring back to Deuteronomy and Leviticus, right? He's referring back. Ever since that time, you've not kept what I said. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, well, how are we to return? Well, will a man rob God? God asks. And yet you rob me. But you ask, how do we rob you? And Malachi says, in tithes and offerings. You're under a curse. That's the curse of Deuteronomy 28. The whole nation of you, because you're robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty. Test me in this. And see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. So, do you see? Like Malachi, there's a prophet speaking to God's people and saying, look, if you are part of my people, this is what I've promised, this is what I say. Okay, so that's kind of where we get to. So Malachi is like, like you're not... You don't even realize it. You don't even realize it. And you're not honoring me. You're not living as I asked you to live. Then Jesus shows up. Click. And Jesus actually comes at this a different way. He looks at the use of the portion that people have. And he says, actually, what you do with your money shows your heart. It shows what you love. And Jesus says, actually, you can't love both God and money. And he says, look, you need to recognize this. Like, this portion that's your own, it's not just do whatever you want with it. No, this shows where you are. And he says, wherever your heart is, that's where your treasure is. Whatever you treasure, that's where your heart is. You can't love money and love God. I mean, that's just like an arrow. Like, isn't that just wow? And he looks at what the Pharisees are doing, and they've given their first fruits, they've given their tithe, but he's looking at all the rest of their stuff that they've got, and he's saying, you don't love me. Your money, how you use your money shows you do not love me, because you're not caring for the poor. You're not meeting the obligation of hospitality. Bang. Mammon. Don't love mammon. Don't love mammon. Because mammon would just wrap you up in chains. He'll bring pain. and misery into your life, it's like a lie. It's a lie. Instead, use your money to sow into the love of God, click.
What do you think? Just keeping you interested.
And so then the closest followers of Jesus, they take on what Jesus says, and they look at all the law, the word of God from the Old Testament that he's got, and then what do? Acts chapter 2. Click. They say they're going to give the first fruits to God. And actually in Paul's letters in 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, he says this, he doesn't, it's really interesting, he doesn't say, I suggest you take some of the money that you get, the first bit, and put it to one side. Paul says, I instructed you, take your first fruits and bring it as part of the collection we're going to give to the churches. Yeah, it's for the brothers in Jerusalem, but for the church that's in poverty. Take the first fruits and do that in the first thing you do for the month. But then we see in Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4, a new level of generosity displayed by the church. And the key phrase that you see in Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4 is that they willingly brought what they had and they laid it at the feet of the apostles so that what? There was no needy person among them. You see, the desire of God, which was explained by him in Deuteronomy chapter 26 and in Leviticus, was that the poor and the needy in the land would be fed and looked after by those who God had given provision to. And in Acts chapter 2, finally, the people of God are living up to the calling that God has given his people. That you would care for the needy, you'd feed the hungry. You'd befriend those who are lonely, and this is what his call is on us, as his people. And you also see in the New Testament, you see Paul saying it, and I think Peter says it as well. He says, don't muzzle the ox while he's treading out the grain. And Paul says, do you think this is about animals? Not really about animals. It's talking about those who serve the church and care for the church, who have been set aside, they don't earn income otherwise. You know, care for them. Give money for them. And so it's almost like they see those who are the full-time pastoral staff of a church in the place of the Levites from Deuteronomy, and it sort of becomes part of what it is to give, to free people up. So we have a few guys who we free up. If you're paid by the church, just want to stand up, just so that people know who you are. We'll start with the most attractive and then work down. So, Lesley. Husbands, take note. Lesley, the most attractive. So Lesley does a day a week for the church as senior pastor and particularly focused on kids. And then Phil Merriman does a day a week. He drinks lattes. Worship and all coordinating all the lads do. And Phil and Caroline, they just, aren't they amazing? Don't you think they're amazing? Just all they coordinate and together, they do 4 days a week. And then Andy Brims does a full time. So he and I are full time, and honestly, it's been amazing since he's joined. The amount of service he's provided to this church, this community, in terms of communications, in terms of gathering people into contexts where they feel welcome and loved and honoured. I like to be rude about him, but he's an amazing man, really. So these are the guys, and I just... what was Okay, so click, I think I've got another slide. And what we see the New Testament model is that God can use money to change your heart. And he, I don't know what your salary is. I don't know if you have a salary. But whatever it is that you receive, honestly, this is the truth. That's God sending that into your life. It's God sending that into your life. And we want to be really open. So as a staff team, Leslie and I think I earn like £19,000 a year, and Leslie gets, what do you get, mate? You do a day and a half, actually. 11,000, something like that. And that is a phenomenal amount of money. Like, it's incredible to have such a huge income coming in. Like, historically, that is astonishing. And internationally, that's extraordinary to have that level of... That's all money just from the Lord. It's a gift. And it's for me to use that. And God wants to use that to change my heart, to set me free, to grow in my love of Him, and to reduce my love of mammon. And it's the same for you, whatever you get. Whatever you get, it's God giving you that and saying, come on, how are you going to use it? And equally, and so how you use it is this. This is what we want to recommend. What are we going to do with this? I hope there's another one. How you use your money is a direct indicator of what you love. I've looked at this a lot of times, and I can't get past that. I wish I could. I wish I could wiggle around it for you and say, hey, don't worry how you spend your money. You know, you can love this thing and feel great about Jesus. Woo, I love singing to Him, but I spend whatever I want to spend it. But, I just can't get past this. I just think this is one of those things where Jesus just... This is just how it is. And when you give money to the church for paying staff, so this is about don't muzzle the ox and treading out the grain, and for caring for the needy, this is about the loving of the poor, I believe that God sees that giving as you giving it directly to Him. Again, I feel a bit uncomfortable about that because you doing that pays my salary, but I do this for free. We did it for free to start with. Not in it for the money. Our salary's not going to increase. We're not going to be paid any more money if you give more. It won't make a blind bit of difference how much we get. It's you giving it to the Lord. He sees it as from Him. I think God sees the percentage that you give more than the money you give. He sees the percentage. And you see this phrase over and again, as much as you are able, or as it is in your capacity. That's the New Testament language. It doesn't talk about tithes, it talks about a proportion as you are able. So I really want to encourage you to think about what percentage is first fruits for you. Nearly fell off the stage then. What percentage is first fruits? And if you work out the percentage, then it actually really can be so helpful, because you can look and think, hey, I give £100. I give £100 a month to the Lord as my first fruits. Well, if your income is £200 a month, then you're giving 50%. And like Jesus is like, wow, they're like, they're amazing. And they're like, look at this, it's like a widow's mite. This is like a widow, she's giving everything she's got to me. Like, this is incredible. And if you're earning £5,000 a month and you're giving £100, then your percentage, I haven't got math skills to work that out, but it's much smaller. And I honestly believe this is liberating. For those of you, and you can't earn a lot of money, you can be like the richest person in God's eyes. You know, like how when somebody's rich, everyone like gravitates towards them. Oh, you know, they're rich, so we love them, you know? And it's almost like God just couldn't care less, but He gravitates towards those who are generous towards Him. You can become, in God's eyes, a millionaire if you choose to just give. And you know, the truth of the Bible is this. When you give to God, you're trading up every single time. You're trading what is temporary for what is eternal. And Jesus says, you know, use what you have now, use your money to build for yourself treasures. And anybody who's given up anything for me will receive it 100 times over, not only in this life, but in the life to come. And you know, we can sometimes look at those who teach the prosperity gospel like, oh, sow into your gifting and God will give you all this. We can kind of sometimes look at them a little bit critically. If you don't know what I'm talking about, just forget about it. We're a little bit critically, but actually there is a truth in the fact that God is generous. He wants to give to you. Now, often the best things he gives are not money. The best things he gives are way, way more than that. It's the relationship with him, the intimacy with him, the fact that when you use something that you've got, you see somebody's life transformed by it, that's way better than an Audi or a plasma TV. Those things, like moths eat them, robbers steal them. That God is generous. Can we just click back to the one? Just go back a couple. That's it, yeah, that's great. If you live with your money in this way, if you invest your money, first fruits, I want to say first fruits of the church, and then throughout the rest of what you have, you're seeking, is the stuff I can give to charities? Is the way I can show hospitality? Is the way that I can just demonstrate the compassion and generosity of the kingdom to people? If you live this way, I honestly believe that you will never have to worry about money. I don't mean that you'll be filthy rich. I don't mean you'll get everything you want. But God sets you free from worry because you know that your Father in heaven sees you and knows you. And as you choose to do what he wants and live how he wants, some of the stuff you used to be stressed about just drops away. Does that make sense? Does a nuance of that come through? Okay, so just click on a couple. How to give. So this is what I suggest you do. Work out what you get in a month. Now some of you work, like you kind of bill, you know, you like kind of contract out or you get paid weekly or whatever, but say it's monthly or say it's weekly or whatever. When you get something in, work out how much it is you get in. And then ask God, what is first fruits? What percentage would be first fruits for me? So you might say, right, I get in, I'll do that in a minute. And then once you've worked out the percentage, then you times the income you get by the percentage. And you work out what is 5% of this amount of money. And then you work it out. And then you give that amount. You just commit to give it. So if you, I think I've got an illustrated click. For average Croydonite, next page. Okay, so say you're earning $27,000 a year, which is the average salary of people in Croydon, I understand. Then your wages would be about $1,800 a month. And if you had kids, you might get some child benefit or child tax credit, or who knows what. And so say your total was $2,010, and you felt like your first fruits, you felt like the percentage that God wanted you to give was 10%. Then you'd work that out, and it was £201 a month you'd give. And then here's the key thing, that goes out first. So then you restrict your other expenditure and you increase your income as much as you can so that you can show generosity and compassion and hospitality with the rest of the stuff you get. Honestly, we've done this for how many years? 15, 20 years. And our income's never been high. It's high in international and historical terms, but I've never earned them. Used to earn more than I do now, quite a lot more, but never more than 45,000, I don't think. So, click. We have some trustees. would you mind just standing, Andy Shuttleworth? Here he is, you can see him here with his, is that Joe? No, it's not Joe. And Dayo. So these guys are our trustees, and as members of the congregation, there's a few other trustees who are from outside as well, they help us as an organisation with our money. Do you know the amount of hidden stuff behind the scenes these guys do? It's incredible. Can we give them just an amazing round of applause? So anything you give, then they are responsible for making sure it's used well. And Dayo is going to come and just tell us a bit about... he's just going to come and do a bit about how we use the money that you give us.
Thank you, Tom. Actually, that picture doesn't look like me, does it? Okay, Tom gave me possibly the most difficult job to do. That was for me to look through the books of CD over the last few years to see how we've been doing in terms of money matters. So I'm going to share with us some of the things I found out. So can we go to the slide, please? Now, Tom talked about the church being involved in a lot of activities. For example, the activities we do with the community. We talked about the street cafe. You have the crafts school. You have the English school. We do all of those things in the community. The first thing I discovered was that all the things we do in church have been financed through the contributions of members of this church. And that's excellent. Nothing comes from any other place. We don't get any contribution from the government. We don't get any subscription from any place. Every single money we've spent on any activity in this church came from contributions of the church.
Next slide.
Now, the church was established in 2013, around February 2013. So we've been in active service in the community for just 4 years. Over that 4 year period, we've seen the number of registered members increasing from 65 in about 2014 to almost 200. And I'm talking about adults. Registered members, almost 200. The children, in excess of 60 or 80. Then the last thing is that increasingly we're becoming more relevant in this community. I've been involved in the street cafe, and the kind of things, the kind of joy you see on the faces of people when you interact with them, it's not something money cannot buy. Many people walk out of the home office, they're dejected, they've been rejected. All they want to do is someone who is going to listen to them, have compassion on them, have a conversation with them, pray with them. And those are the kind of things that we do. We've been involved with refugees, people who just came into England, and the following day they have somebody who is friendly, talk to them, help them through the process, and help them settle. So I'll tell you that in 4 years, and we have been in Croydon Vineyard for almost 2 years, and it's incredible the kind of things we've seen the church do within the community. We've been Christian for many years, but I'll tell you, the impact CV makes in this community is phenomenal. It's not something that you can compare to many other churches. And it's a small congregation. So the last thing I'm going to say on this slide is that thank you so much. Thank you for giving to Croydon Vineyard. Your giving, no matter how little it appears, has gone a long way to help the church do what it's doing within the community. Thank you. Now I'm going to go to the next slide just to show you in actual terms how your contributions have helped over the last couple of years. And I've done that graph just to show you the average income that comes through. Remember I've said all the income is from contributions of members of this church. On the average, you can see, something's missing there. The years are missing. The extreme left is 2014, and on the extreme right is up to August of this year. But that showed the numbers in terms of average monthly income. So somewhere in 2016, we actually had a peak in the average income. That's the spike that you see at the top there, of about almost 15,000 pounds was the average income that came to the church post in 2017. But in this year, we've seen that has dropped. Okay, we've only, this is October. I looked at records up to August, and the average we've seen in 2017, when I say 2017, is actually from March of this year up to August, is about 10,000. And that's considerably lower than what we did in this period last year, and compared to the budget that we made for this year, which is about 15,000 pounds. Of course, because we have increasingly been involved in things within the community, that means that our monthly expenditure has been increasing as well. And as a result of that, the average expenditure is now higher than the average income. Imagine, that means that we're spending more money now than the money that comes in. We've been able to survive this year because in the past, we were able to make some savings. We had more income than the expenditure, and we've saved them, but now we're digging into the purse, into the savings. The idea of having savings is to ensure that in months where we have lower income, we will be able to supplement, but consistently having lower income compared to the expenditure is basically going to make the savings go away. And there are other things, bigger things we're thinking about, and you can see we currently rent this place, and that costs almost about 8,000, I think, about 8,000. It's about 1,200 a month, 1,200 a month. One of the visions that we have is to have a permanent place for us where we can worship and where we can do all of the various activities. And we need to build that war chest in a way to help us do that. So, but if we're digging into that, it means long term we will not be able to move out of a temporary accommodation to do that. Tom introduced the staff members of the church. We currently have six staff members who the church pays. Only two of them are full-time, the rest of them are part-time, but they get something from the church for the services they provide. So what you see is that about two-thirds of the income, about two-thirds of the expenditure, is actually towards paying the salaries and the wages of this staff. And if you look at the average expenditure, to be frank, for six people, average salary of about, I think it came to about 8,000 a month for about six people. You agree with me that it's not so much, but by the time you spread it out across six people, not everybody gets the same thing. But the fact is that it's a lot of money, but it's not that much as well. So I think a couple of key messages for me from this, looking through the numbers, is that currently we don't have enough income coming through. Okay, our expenditure is higher than the income. There are two ways to solve this. Okay, it's either we cut back on the activities so that the expenditure comes down within the range of the income. It means pulling back from the community. Or we can give more in such a way that we can continue doing the good stuff we're doing within Croydon. The second thing is that actually the second option is what I believe God prefers. You know, God wants us to actually increase our giving so that we're not pulling back, so that we, you know, increase the number of activities, interaction we have within the community. We can increase and have more interaction with people, bring the word of God to people in the different ways we currently do that. So I would encourage every one of us to think about how we can give more. Okay, I think Tom mentioned it. The kind of giving can come in different ways. You know, we're talking about giving in monetary terms. We can also give in you giving time, getting more involved in some of the various activities. You can provide materials as well, so that we do not have to buy stuff. You know, we've got the food bank, for example, there. But what is key amongst all of these three is for us to be able to ensure we have sufficient amount of money for us to pay the rent, pay the salaries and wages, and continue to fund all the various activities. So I would encourage every one of us to go to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit help us to decide, and this is going to be a personal decision. It's nothing of compulsion. It's got to be led by the Spirit. It's only when the Spirit allows you to give that you should give truly. And that is what I'm going to encourage. I think I've got the last slide. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you so much.
I know your heart's sinking right now, but don't worry, I'm going to be super quick. So we're not worried about money, by the way. Father God has very deep pockets. We just tell you these things so you know the way it is. That's why we're sharing them. So we also believe, we've said all these things already, we also believe God wants to use your money to change this town. It's not just about stuff that goes on in here. You've heard a lot about it already. That's because we don't live in a vacuum. We're talking about money and giving in the abstract, but we don't live in a vacuum. We are situated here, in this place, in this time. And the Lord has called us, the Lord has called you, to bring Croydon to life, to bring his life to Croydon. And that's why we focus, we believe, wants to use your money to do these things in this town we live in. And we believe there are, as we've already said before in our vision when Tom shared it a few weeks ago, there are particularly four things that we believe the Lord is having us push into. We just want to do what we see him doing. And we see these four areas he's already doing stuff in, and we want to follow into that. First of all, we want to increase our investment in our 0 to 18s. Now you know I'm passionate about this, it's our limit. We want to increase our investment in our 0 to 18s. Croydon has more 0 to 18s than nearly any other London borough. They're already here, they're already around us. We don't need to go looking. The stats show that 0 to 18s feel higher levels of loneliness, depression, and self-harm than ever. And some of this is because they live in a world of social media. Apparently there was a Rethinking Culture survey that asked the question, what are the top three things that make you feel bad about yourself? And about 67% of young people who were surveyed said social media. And they live in the world of social media more than we do. And it's not just teenagers, because the average age of a child getting a mobile phone is 11 and 12. So we need to reach this generation with the awesome love of Jesus. So we want to be investing in our 0 to 18 works. And we're already seeing amazing stuff happen. The Lord is doing stuff already, which is why we want to push into that. I'm going to try and get Alan and Mel in the next few weeks to talk about their four-year-old who said he wasn't really hearing from God. And so they asked God to talk to him, and he had a dream where Jesus showed himself to him. I won't ruin the story, I'll let him tell that later. Kemi, who was serving on the Pebbles team one week, came to us and said, there's a six-year-old in the group, and during the prayer time, it was just like a normal prayer time, he came up to me afterwards, he had this extended vision where Jesus had showed himself to him and spoke to him, and it was like a six-year-old. It's amazing. Our project B, the young people, our teenagers, they're putting on a music night, hiring out Project B, they're providing free food, they're flyering, they're doing all the work themselves, they're inviting friends, and it's going to be a music night, but it's going to be a gospel presentation, because they have come alive in Jesus. Over the last few months, we've seen Sal and Hannah working with them. They have just absolutely come alive with knowing Jesus, and what he's doing in them is amazing. And they are now wanting to share that with other teenagers in Croydon, and it's amazing. Next week, you lucky people, the youth band are going to lead worship. They've formed a band, they practice all the time, they love to worship God. We just want to invest in that more. So we want to increase our investment in our 0 to 18s. We also want to expand Vineyard English School and Refugee Ministry. You've already heard a lot about that, but I just want to say, for those who don't know, that Croydon is home to the UK's Home Office, which means the town is the first port of call for people who want to settle in the UK, claiming asylum or a visa. This means Croydon is a true mix from every nation. It's truly international. And when Jesus said, go out and make disciples of all nations, we really believe we don't have to go out. The nations are here in Croydon for this very reason, which is why we do things like the English school, which is why we do befriending, street cafe, make it craft, and things like that. I just want to tell you like one thing about, you've heard about English school, I've got loads of stories, English school, make it craft, all sorts of things, but one thing about befriending was there was an Albanian lady who'd been, I won't tell you her whole story because it breaks confidentiality, but she'd been trafficked and she was pregnant. And she was here temporarily, and she had no one. She was going to give birth. So if you've ever had a baby, can you imagine giving birth with absolutely no one? And Yvonne made friends with her through the English school and other things. And Yvonne was actually there helping her give birth. She gave up her time to go, and there's been an amazing relationship formed throughout. The woman really has seen Jesus through that. So that is like a simple way that the Lord is moving. So he's moving already in this area of internationality. So we want to invest in that more. We want to start a 6 p.m. service. Okay, so we're growing on Sundays. We're growing more people every week. And we've played with all sorts of things, haven't we? How could we accommodate this? We changed the room around, the layout, and things like that. And we really feel he is moving us towards a 6 p.m. service, an evening service. And this means there's more opportunities to grow, more opportunities for people to come, to hear the gospel, to encounter Jesus and to be loved into his family. And it will be similar to what we do on a Sunday morning, but it will be a slightly different feel, drawing on a whole new crowd. It means more people get to grow, more people get to use their gifts in that service, but also those who are tireless team who serve on kids' teams and don't get to be in for the teaching were saying they could come and serve in the morning and then come back for the evening to get teaching. But it would also opens up a whole new area for new people in Croydon to come and hear the word and come to life. We wanted there to be a sense of creativity, experimentation, faith, new life. Absolutely wonderful. So we want to start a 6 p.m. service. And the last thing we want to do is we want to start saving towards a building, as has already been said. At the moment, we rent all the space we use on an hour-by-hour basis. A permanent home would increase our ability to offer welcome to all kinds of people in Croydon and would enable midweek ministries. We want it to be a wide open space in the community through the link we've already got. God's already doing it, so we feel like this is the next step. We see a congregation who've prayed and scouted and battled for the building, given and sacrificed and made this a reality. We want to see some people step up to the task and make it happen. And for all of us to be able to tell the story of God's favour making the impossible possible. Because that's the business God is in. With all of this, increasing our investment in our 0 to 18s, expanding Vineyard English School, Refugee Ministry, starting a 6 p.m. service, and starting saving towards a building, God's business is training ordinary people like you and me to do the extraordinary through the power of God in the name of Jesus. If you'd like to stand. I just say, come Holy Spirit, come, we welcome you. Come and move in us.